Today we finish up 21 days of prayer and fasting. You made it. Along with the 21 days of prayer and fasting, we have been doing a 21 days of rediscovery, a journey into the presence of God. And one of the first things that we discovered was fasting. Rediscovering fasting is having your iPad not work. It makes you pray a lot. All right, so here we go. I'll leave the slides to them. How about I'll just preach, okay? There we go, we're good? Okay. When we fast, we set aside what sustains us physically for the one who sustains us spiritually. That's what fasting is. It's clearing away the clutter. It's clearing away so that we can better hear from the Lord. We also looked at rediscovering God's word. And one of the ways that we rediscover God's word is through all right. One of the ways we rediscover God's word is that we study it for ourselves personally. Yes. YouTube is great. Podcasts are great, but it is not a substitution for learning what God has to say for you through his word. Amen. And then you take whatever he gives you through his word, and you ask this question: what does that mean to me today? How can I apply God's word today? That's rediscovering God's word. And then we talked about prayer, rediscovering prayer. More specifically, rediscovering our peace through prayer. And I know we struggled a little bit with this one last week, but it's not the answers that we seek. That's not the power of prayer. It's not the answer we seek. It's the peace we receive. Yes. That's the power of prayer. Because we talked about that even when you pray and nothing has changed, when you're finished praying, you feel better. But it's not that you feel better. It's that you've received God's peace. Because he says, when you make your request known to me, I will give you peace. That makes no sense. So what were you chasing this week? What were you chasing last week? What were you chasing the week before? What were you chasing during these 21 days of prayer and fasting? What was it that you needed to hear from God? What was it that you were seeking from him that you needed him to do in your life? Was there a purpose behind your prayer and fasting, or were you just starving yourself for Jesus? Fasting is one of those things, when you read scripture, it's one of the first things that they do, is fast and pray when they need God to move. And I think sometimes we can get a little caught up in our circumstances, that we don't see God moving. We miss it. Prayer and fasting helps clear out the clutter so we can see that. But what about the impossible? What about that thing that is impossible? What about that relationship that is impossible? What about that financial need that is impossible? What about that thing going on at work that's just impossible? What then? During these 21 days of prayer and fasting, I have learned something. And I've learned how to approach God differently. I found myself in his presence, sitting, not wanting to read my Bible, not wanting to pray, not wanting to worship, just wanting to sit and be. Just being in his presence. Because fasting and prayer kind of takes you there. This 21 weeks has been an amazing time, and I hope you've enjoyed some of that too. But I've been reacquainted with the wonder and the awe of God. I've been reacquainted with the Alpha and the Omega. I've been reacquainted with the one who sent his son to die for me. And maybe for the first time in a very long time, I've begun to see that the impossible is possible with God. That the impossible is possible. Most of us, I think, in this room, we would say that we have faith. Right? Say we have faith, right? And probably 21 days of prayer and fasting, it's probably strengthened that faith. That's probably reasonable, right? And it, you know, when you're praying and you're focusing on the God, your faith is increased, right? But what do you do about those things that are impossible? That can't be done. There's no way. Some of us have been fighting and struggling with the impossible for so long that some of us have stopped bringing those to the Lord. I mean, we know that God does the impossible. He's just busy doing the impossible for somebody else. But God is the God of He's just God. He's just the great I am. He can do whatever he wants to do, when he wants to do it, and how he wants to do it. But when we're faced with things in our life that we just can't find a way through, there's no path forward. You can't, well, let's just say you're on plan B, C, D, E, F. You're all the way back to S or T, and you still cannot find a way through. So what is your impossible? What is your impossible? Just think for a minute. What is it that you need God to move, and there's no other way that it gets done? Because here's, let me tell you a secret. You want to know a secret? If you can get to a place that you can believe him for the impossible, you can believe him for anything. Anything. Think about that. What's going on right now in your life where you need God to move? Well, you can believe him for the impossible. You can believe him for that. So I want you to think for a second. What is your impossible? And then I want you to think about God doing something extraordinary. Can you picture it? Because here's what I've learned. And I want to share with you this morning through a very well-known story. A lot of you will have learned this story way back in Sunday school. Some of you may be hearing this for the first time. But there is a story of Jesus where he does the impossible. There's just no other way. There is no other way for it to be done but the hands of the Master. But here's what you're going to see in this story. Is that he took so little to do so much, but what he had was everything. The people gave him everything. And so when we talk about prayer and fasting and studying God's word, we are laying a foundation. And out of that foundation, we place everything that we have into the hands of the Master. And he performs the miraculous. Amen. Father God, we love you, worship you. Jesus, we love you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you this morning. Pierce our hearts with your word, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want you to turn your Bibles with me. Again, some of you are going to recognize this story. Go to John 6, chapter 6, verse 1. chapter 6, verse 1. If you have a Bible like mine, at the top it'll say, feeding of the 5,000. John 6, verse 1 says, after this, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Verse 2, and a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. Look at verse 2 again. And a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. I'm 56. I will go downstairs and forget why I went downstairs. So I will go back upstairs with no more clarity than when I went downstairs. That, my friends, is called short-term memory loss. And I think that we unfortunately struggle with that when it comes to Jesus, because we forget the things that he's done on the sick, on the broken, on those that need to be restored, on the miracle side. Many of us in here have witnessed the power and the glory of Jesus touching someone's life, yet we face something else that we haven't faced before, and we forget. Here's what happens a lot, and I think you'll recognize this. You're in the middle of something brand new that you've not faced before, and you don't know what the path forward is. You have no idea how this is going to work out. You're just not sure what to do. Right? Now, what happens is that we immediately should just go, you got this, sir? Jesus, you see what's happening here? I trust you. I believe you. I'll just get out of the way while you handle this. But we don't do that. The problem is we get so focused on everything that's going on around us, our circumstances, the things, the situations, that we allow that to cloud and to remove and to make it very hard for us to remember what Jesus has already done in our life. We become distracted. I want to show you what I mean. Here's what I want you to do. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes in just a moment. I want you to close your eyes. And then I'm going to ask you to open them. When you open them, I want you to see everything in this room that's brown. Everything, find everything in this room that's brown. And then when I tell you, I want you to close your eyes again. You ready? All right, close your eyes. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Open your eyes, look around, find everything that's brown. Everything that's brown. Everything that is the color of brown. Look around. See, I find everything that's brown. Okay, close your eyes. Open your eyes. Tell me one thing you saw that's blue.
My pants.
See, I gave you a break. I let you open your eyes again. It's extremely difficult when you keep your eyes closed, because what happens is your brain becomes so focused on the color brown that that's all you see. And you're looking around and you're looking past all kinds of things that are blue. Just like when we can get so caught up in our circumstances that we look all past what Jesus has already done. Come on, somebody. Yes. We miss the move of God because we're so focused on what's new that we forget that, by the way, he's already handled that. Amen. Remember last week when we talked about praying, thanking God in the middle of praying before he's done anything? Why do we do that? Because that's a step of faith. We're thanking God for what he's already going to do. And so what happens is our circumstances can be so overwhelmed, the brown in our life can cover up the blue. And we miss what God has for us. But the disciples, how many of you just love the disciples? Don't you love them? Why do you love them? Because they're just like us. They're just like us. See, what you don't realize is the word after in that passage is extremely significant. After what? The verse before it? No. Jesus had just healed with speaking an official of the temple, his son who was dying. Your son will live. Just like that. After that. Oh, by the way, the disciples were there. And he also had healed a man 38 years he had been invalid. 38 years beside a pool. Jesus said, "Do you want to get well? Stand up, take your mat, and go home." And the disciples were there. So after is so significant because they had seen all of those wonderful things that Jesus had already done. So when we step into this story that we're about to step into, you have to understand that the disciples have seen him do the miraculous. And Jesus says, just like he does with us, I'm going to give him another chance. Come on now. Anybody in here thankful for second chances? Amen. And Jesus doesn't say, well, you missed it. Good luck with that. Verse 3. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. Now the Passover feast of the Jews was at hand. Verse 5, lifting up his eyes, then and seeing that a large crowd was coming towards him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people can eat?" Lifting up his eyes, then he seeing the large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we going to buy bread that these people may eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself, Jesus, knew what he would do. You ever been tested? You ever been tested by Jesus? It's hard. Have you ever been tested when you're doing all the right things? You're studying God's word. You're not even doing that open the verse and hope you find something routine. You're seriously studying the book of John or Genesis, or you've rolled up your sleeves and you stepped into the book of Revelation. Like, you're all in. You are in God's word studying. You're praying. Your devotions are not a tick box. They are a part of your life. You're spending praying and studying God's word. You even started fasting early. You started fasting on day 7. And God tests you. Sends something your way just to see what you'll do. That's what he's saying. He said, "Philip, where are we going to buy food? Where are we going to buy the food?" A crowd is walking towards them. Because they've seen what Jesus could do. There's thousands of people walking. I mean, how would you like to be Philip? "Hey, Phil, where are we going to buy food?" I mean, what do you even say? But Jesus said, "I'm going to teach you something, Philip. I'm going to strengthen your faith. I'm going to test you because I already know what I'm going to do." See, sometimes we're put in situations that we can't see the way forward. They seem impossible to us. And the Lord, come on now, already knows. Amen. Come on now. Yeah. Come on. Just fill in the blank. Already knows what he's going to do. Because here's why. Faith that can't be tested can't be trusted.
Yes. Amen.
Faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. You've heard me say this many times. Having faith in God is not the same as trusting God. Having faith in God will save you. Having trust in God will change your life. Because you've taken your hands off the wheel and you've said, "Lord, you know, I'm going to let you drive. I'm going to trust you to take me where I need to go, which is why God tests our faith to increase our trust in him. Have you been tested in your life? Have you had tests in your life where God has allowed something to come into your life you don't understand why? He's walked you through it, and on the other side of it, how's your faith? Yeah. Right? Stronger, solid. It's better. Why? Because it's been tested.
Yes. Amen.
I always think of when I think about testing faith, I always think of fine, like fine gold or fine metal. You know, they smelt that stuff. They melt it down so the impurities float to the surface so it's pure. They don't do that with ice water. They do that with fire.
Yes.
It melts it down. It breaks it down. But at the end, it's so much more pure. That's what God does through testing.
Yes.
So when you're praying today, here's what I want you to do. Father, please test me. Don't do that. He'll do it all by himself. But I wonder how did Philip do? Let's see how Philip did with the test. You want to see? Here's how Philip did. Philip answered him. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get a little. Now, how much is 200 denarii? 8 months of wages. Almost 3/4 of a year of wages would not allow the group of people standing before them to get just a little bit of bread, little bit of rice, little bit of food. That means if you worked from January to August, you wouldn't have enough money to feed them. You'd have enough money to give them a bite, a taste. So that's Philip's answer. Hey, Phil, where are we going to get food? Are you serious right now, Jesus? Have you seen the size of this crowd? If I had 8 months of wages, 200 denarii, Jesus, we could only give them a taste. We couldn't feed them. They'd still be hungry. Let me translate it for you. Lord, this is impossible. It's not possible. So what you're asking of me is not possible. The situation that I'm in is not possible. Sound familiar?
Amen.
Lord, there's no way forward. It's impossible. It is not able to occur, exist, or be done. Jesus, there is no way. God, there is no way. Have you prayed that prayer in your life? You don't have to raise your hands, but I have prayed that prayer. God, there is no way forward. I do not know how to do this. This is impossible. That was Philip's answer. Standing before a man who had saved a young man from dying and had healed a man who had been lame for 38 years, just a few days prior. Jesus, this is impossible. I know what you did before. Come on. I know what you did before, Lord, but this is new. This is different. We've never been here before. I can't see the way forward, God. I know what you've done in my life before, but now this is different. You know what I'm saying? You've been there? Impossible. Not able to occur. Exist or be done. Now see, the other disciples are there. Jesus is there with Philip. The others are back here. And they're hearing all of this. I'm sorry. Sometimes things in my head. I'm just wondering if one of the disciples is like, man, Phil is really getting his smack down right now. If I was up there, I know what to say. He is just blowing it. Just a little trust, just a little faith in the middle of the impossible. Watch. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "You know, there's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they for so many? Lord, I know what you've done before, but this time it's different. But you know, there's a boy here. He's got 5 loaves, 2 fish. It's all he's got. It's not much." Andrew has just a little bit of hope. Because why would he have brought him to Jesus if he didn't have a little bit of hope? Hey, Carson, come here for a minute. Thanks, buddy. So what do you got there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's it? What else you got? Oh, what is this? Oh, won't you unwrap that one? Let's see what we got here. Oh, looks like 2 fish. What do you got there? You got another one? Yeah?
Raw.
Probably have to cook it.
Yeah.
This is it, huh?
Yeah, that's put it on the grill.
Put it on the grill. We've got 2 fish and 5 loaves. Okay? Right? Now, what else is in your bag? You got anything else in there?
No.
Are you sure? Make sure. Okay. Yeah. All right. This is it. Now, 5,000 people. Little guy brings us lunch. This is not enough to feed us. Is it?
No.
I mean, even if you've not, I mean, you've been fasting. So I know y'all, in fact, y'all need to just back off. Everybody just relax. Carson brought his lunch. Sushi and rolls. This is not even enough to feed us. But this Carson, you did perfect, because watch this. Did you see what Carson did when I say, "Hey, what's in your bag?" He starts taking it out. Do you think Jesus made them? "Hey, grab the kid, hold him down, steal his lunch." Right? "I want to do a miracle. Hold him down. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Come here." No. It brought the lunch, and the little boy gave it. Just like Carson. "Here you go, Lord." There's such a lesson in there for us. His bag is empty. There's nothing else in his little bag. He's given everything that he has. It is. It's a bad smell.
Yes.
We would cook it first, wouldn't we?
Yes. It would smell.
Do you have any more fish in your bag? Any more stinky? No. Nothing. The bag is empty because Carson, like that little boy, gave everything that he had. That's the lesson for us. If we want the impossible to become possible, then we must be willing to give the Lord everything. Amen. Everything. All of it. When Jesus was testing Philip, he wasn't testing his intellect. He wasn't testing his ability to work hard. He wasn't testing his clarity. He was testing his faith. "Will you trust me with everything that you have?" If we want the possible, then we have to trust Jesus with all of it, right? Thanks, buddy. I love you. You can go sit down. This is what Jesus had. It's not much. Please hear me. What you look at in your hands and in your heart and in your mind may to you seem like not much, especially with what you face in your life. But Jesus says, you know what? If you give me all of it, if you give me everything you have, it'll be enough. It'll be enough. And one of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there's a boy. His 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. It's not much for so many. And this is our verse for today. Verse 10. And Jesus said, have the people sit down. Have the people sit down. We got 5 loaves. We got 2 fish. It ain't much, Jesus. He says, have the people sit down. Can you not just for a moment, just picture the disciples. Philip's talking to Jesus, and then Andrew comes up. Disciples are back. Andrew says, well, we've got 5 loaves and 2 fish. It's not much for all these people. And can't you just sort of see the disciples start to, well, let's go ahead and we'll start breaking up the people. Let's start having them go home, and let's start moving things around here and get them going. And Jesus says, hey, and they're like, okay, here we go. He's going to tell us to dismiss them all. And hey, guys, hold on a minute. And he's like, we're just going to send them all home right now. And Jesus says, hey, have them sit down. What? Say what? He sounded like he said, have them sit down. Sit down where? And it says, now there was much grass in the place. He had him sit down in the place. Not go home. Not dismiss. So you have them sit. Have them sit down. Have them wait. He's about to do something. See, that's what fasting and prayer and being in God's word will do. It'll help you wait while Jesus begins to do the miraculous. Amen. Have them sit down. About 5,000 in number. They say about because it says men, and so there were probably married families there. There's probably many more thousand people than just 5. But hey, 5,000 is enough for 5 loaves and 2 fish. Have them sit down. Folks, I want you to hear this morning. That there are things that you are facing in your life. And you want to run. You want to run. You want to hide. You want to hide from the world. You want to hide from yourself. And you certainly want to hide from God. But I'm telling you right now that Jesus is saying, sit. Wait, I'm about to do something miraculous. I'm about to take your impossible and I'm about to make it possible. Because you're willing to give me everything that you have. I'm gonna receive it from you, and I'm gonna do something that will blow your mind. So if this is for you, don't run. Sit and wait. Verse 9. Sorry, verse 11. Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, step 1, give all you have to Jesus, and then be thankful. So, well, Donnie, he hasn't done anything yet. I know, but remember, that's our step of faith. I'm going to give you everything I have. I'm going to give you my stinky fish, my hard rolls. Give you everything I got, Lord. It's not much, but I'm going to give it to you. And then I'm going to thank you for what you're going to do. Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. As much as they wanted. Not just a little taste. As much as they wanted. So I think the question for us this morning is are we willing to trust Jesus with all we have, all of it, everything mentally, everything in your heart, physically, your calendar, your finances, your world? Are we willing to place those in the hands of Jesus, expecting him to do the miraculous? Jesus took so little and did so much, and that's what he wants to do for you. He wants to take so little. You discount what you have. God, this is all I've got. Like Moses, I can't even talk. And God freed a nation through him after 400 years of slavery. It's all I got. And Jesus said, if it's all you have, then it's enough. Because I'm enough. And I'm sufficient. I'm all you need. I came across a question that kind of rocked my world a little bit. I was on a phone call, actually. And a pastor friend of mine who was talking to the group said, if Jesus was all you had and everything else was taken away, all of it, all your possessions, your family, everything that you hold dear, if it was all taken away, would Jesus be enough? I'm a pastor. I'm like, yeah. Wait, do you mean my girls? You mean my wife? All of it. Placing it in the hands of the Lord, expecting him to do the miraculous, the impossible. Look at 12. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, gather up the leftover fragments that nothing may be lost. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, gather up the leftover fragments that nothing may be lost. Verse 13. So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves by those who had eaten. Now, don't you hear that? Not only did the Lord meet the need, he overflowed it. He blessed them. When I was reading this passage, I was thinking of the message that Tracy taught us a year or so ago when she made just a dirty word. Like, I can't even type that, let alone say that. God, would you just. Remember that message? I can't even pray that. I can't speak it. I go to type it, and I have to use the word only and make sure it works. Because Jesus didn't. I'm not saying it. You say it. He didn't just make what they needed. He overflowed it. It was more than they could eat. You just got to picture this. They're sitting on a hillside, starving. The disciples are freaked out. Like, how are we going to feed all these people? And Jesus takes 5 little loaves of bread and 2 fish, and he prays over and says, Father, thank you for these. And he begins to break them, and he begins to give them to the disciples. By the way, he used men to feed other men. He used people to take care of other people. Do you see that? Serving. And we're going to come back to that. But Jesus said, hey, here, give this to them. And he started to break it. And he started to tear it. And it got more and more and more. And finally, the people sitting on the side of the hill were like, we're so full. Please stop. I can't eat anymore. I can't. Please, I've got, no, I'm fine. Here, please take this. Take this away. They're full. There's 12 baskets of leftovers. God took what was impossible, made it possible. And then there was an abundance that came out of the impossible. That's how our God is. But he requires something of us. He requires everything. All of it. Yes. How many people served, not including Jesus?
12.
How many baskets were left over?
12.
The Lord honors those who serve. The Lord honors those who serve. He takes care of those that he works through, and he blesses them abundantly. I want you to see. You've got to see this. That we didn't just learn how to pray and learn how to read scripture and learn how to starve ourselves for the sake of not being hangry. Folks, these last 21 days, we laid a foundation that we will build on, I hope as individuals, but we will build on this as a church. Because one of the ways that you can clear out the clutter, one of the ways that you can focus your life, one of the ways that you can give everything that you have to the Lord, no matter how small, one of the ways that you can do that is through fasting, praying, and studying his word. So when you are faced your impossible, some of you are going to face the impossible tomorrow. Some of you are facing the impossible right now. Some of you may not face the impossible until a year from now or 2 years from now, but I want you to come back. We're going to do something in just a moment to help you remember this day. I promise you we'll never forget this in church. But you're going to come back to this moment and you're going to remember that Jesus did the impossible with very little, but it was all that there was to give. And the way you will get there is through fasting and praying and studying God's word and let it speak into your heart. That's how you will turn your impossible to possible. I'm going to ask our servers to come forward. And then I think in the back of the sanctuary back there is where they are ready for us. So if you guys will go back there. Yeah, maybe knock on the door and let them know. We're going to break our fast together today. Go ahead, gentlemen, you can start handing those out. The bread is homemade. The fish sticks are not. Now, for some of you that may be put off by the fish sticks, it was better than my original plan.
Thank you.
They talked me out of it. Said, Donnie, really? Fish sticks and bread? Seriously? Thank you. Fish sticks and bread in church to break a 21-day fast. My pastor has lost his mind. We did supply ketchup just in case. Here's why. A little bit of bread, a little bit of fish, placed in the hands of Jesus, did the miraculous. And when you are facing your impossible, whether it is today, tomorrow, a week from now, 6 weeks from now, a year from now, or 3 years from now, I hope that you remember this crazy moment and this crazy pastor that fed you fish sticks and bread in church. And from there, you'll go, you know, I remember at Hope Chapel that I had fish sticks and bread. And it seemed kind of weird then. Didn't make a lot of sense back then. But you know what? Now that I think about it, I think that message was about, it was where Jesus fed the 5,000. And so you know, if Jesus could do a miracle then, because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, if he can do a miracle back then with 5,000 people, then he can do a miracle in my life right now, because Jesus can do it again. And so whether it's tomorrow or years from now, you look back on this crazy moment of fish sticks and bread, and you remember your God is able to do more and far more abundantly than what you could ever think or imagine. I know you got your hands full, so I'm not going to make you stand up or ask you to stand up, but I don't want to leave this moment and not provide an opportunity to pray. And specifically to pray for those who may be facing an impossible right now. So all I want you to do is I just want you to put your hand up wherever you are. If you're facing something impossible, there's one there, there's one back there, one over here. If you could find your way to make sure that you can make some contact with them, that you can put your hand on their shoulder. If you're comfortable with that, please ask them. But if you're facing the impossible, and you just put your hand up right back here, anybody else back there, anybody else facing the impossible? There's no way path, there's just no forward way. I don't know how to move forward. I'm on plan G and it's not working. We're going to stand with you this morning as we sit. We're going to stand with you right alongside you. And we're going to place everything that you have, everything that we have in the hands of the Master, and we're going to ask Jesus for a miracle. We're going to ask Jesus for a miracle. So I'm going to ask those of you that are surrounding the folks with their hands up, if you would just begin to pray. All over this place, you pray out loud. Let's just pray to the Father and ask Jesus to move. Father God, we don't know these situations. We don't need to know these situations. But you do. You know. And Father, what we are asking is that we, as we place everything, our intellect, our heart, our emotions, our feelings, our physical bodies, as we place everything that we have into your hands, Jesus, we ask you to do a miracle. We ask you to move. There is no way to move. We ask you to tear down those that are impossible to be torn down. Lord, we ask you to restore the unrestorable. We ask you to heal where there is no healing. God, we're asking for the impossible. And Jesus, we're placing everything that we have into your hands. And Jesus, we're going to thank you. We're going to thank you for what you are doing right now and what you will do. We believe. We pray all of this in the precious name and the authority of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Stay right where you are, enjoying your fish sticks. I'd just like to bless you before we leave today. So hold your hands out if you can. May the God of hope give you incredible joy and peace. May he fill you with hope to overflowing, because he is the God of impossible. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Enjoy your fish sticks and remember this moment.
Try to stop your love, and you would wage a war.